This world has nothing for me. This life is not my own. I know you go before me, and I am not alone. This mountain rises higher. The way seems so unclear, but I know that you go with me, so I will never fear. I will trust in you. Whatever will come our way, through fire or pouring rain, oh, we won't be shaken. No, we won't be shaken. Whatever tomorrow brings, together we'll rise and sing. That we won't be shaken. No, we won't be shaken. Trust in you, and we won't be shaken. We will trust in you, and we will not be moved. We will trust in you, yeah, we won't be shaken. We will trust in you.
morning, New Hope Metro. How are you doing? That's great. Why don't you stand with me this morning? Let's welcome God into this place. You know what, God? We thank you for your presence. We thank you for this opportunity we can gather together, Lord. We ask for your presence in this place. Help us to worship you. And if you're with me, everybody said, amen.
Yes, we are here to worship God. And we are going to celebrate because he saved you, he has forgiven you, and he has set you free. And he's given you joy, so you can put your hands together and worship the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Amen.
I'm trading my sorrows. I'm trading my shame.
Yourself to Jesus and you tell him, Lord, I'm trading my sorrows. I can't do this without you. And I want to give you my pain. And he'll say, you know what, in exchange, I'm going to give you joy. Can you say amen to that? So the God that you love, the God that loves you, is going to give you joy.
I You are my morning sun. Though darkness fills the night, it cannot hide the light. Whom shall I fear? You crush the enemies underneath my feet. You are my sword and shield. Though troubles linger still, whom shall I fear? I know who goes before me.
Phrase into your memories. The God of angel armies is always by my side. The God of angel armies is always by my side. This week, when the devil comes after you and you feel him pressing in closer to you, proclaim that statement. The God of angel armies is always by my side. Would you say that together with me? The God of angel armies is always by my side.
Yes, Heavenly Father, we worship you, dear God. The Lord is my light and salvation. Whom shall I fear? Whom shall I be afraid? The Lord is my light and salvation. Whom shall I fear? Whom shall I be afraid? Master, Father, I'll wait for you. I will wait for you. I will remain confident in this. I will see the goodness of the Lord. I will remain confident in this. I will see the goodness of the
I will remain.
I will remain.
Lord.
I gotta tell you, it takes guts to say that. It takes guts to say, I will remain confident. You see, confidence is nice. You can be momentarily confident. You can be, let's be honest. Some of us have had alcohol-induced confidence at times, right? I can do it. I got it. Some of us have had confidence based on our accomplishments, on things that we've done, on things that we feel like we can do. That if our house is big enough, or our bank accounts are cushy enough, if our cars are fast enough, if people look at us a certain way, we can have confidence in so many things. But a song like this takes guts to not just say and sing, but to live. Out of the depth of this idea that God, my hope can be found in so many things, but I refuse to set my hope on people, on what I make or I don't make. I refuse to set my hope on the things that I know already, on the people that I know love me or the people that I don't care if they don't love me. Because people will let us down, won't they? People have let us down, haven't they? And finances are here today, gone tomorrow. The market moves with the climate of business. And where do we put our hope when everything else seems so uncertain? See, the beauty and really the audacity, really the part of Christianity that makes no sense at all is saying, God, although I've never seen you, my hope is found in you. Because I've seen what you've done in my life, and I've seen what you've done in others' lives, and I've seen what you've promised you'll do, and my hope is found in you and your faithfulness. Amen. And we serve, as we sang, an everlasting God, a God that never shifts or changes like sands or tides. We serve a God that says, I am with you and I am for you, so put your hope in me. Church, let's do that today. I know that many of you went through different things this morning to get here. And we had a half marathon coming through, and we had rain and wind, and we have a cruise ship coming. We had all the things going on, and all of our teams are going, we have so many things happening, we didn't realize it. And you know, the common demeanor was, man, God must be up to something, because Satan will stop at nothing to make this not happen. So you know what we're going to do? We're going to pray, and we're going to pray with confidence. Because he who is faithful is with us. Amen? Let's pray. Jesus, we celebrate the power of the cross, because it's by the power of the cross and the gospel that we are found. And not in what people say about us, not in the job titles we hold, not in the family members that we have, not in the good or the bad of our lives, not of the things at school and what friends say about us. Forget that, Jesus. We are here because of you. And our hope and our confidence is found in what you say. So, Lord Jesus, we are your sons and your daughters. You are our light and our salvation. So who shall we fear? What shall we fear? Well, the world is a scary place at times. And God, to be honest, sometimes uncertainty racks us. And sometimes we shiver. But this morning, we stand on the rock. So, Lord, you are strong enough for us. May your joy be our strength. So with hearts of joy, we celebrate the name of Jesus, and we all say together, amen. Let's give a hand to him this morning. Hey, you got to turn to two people next to you and two people in front and back of you and say, good morning. Welcome to New Hope Metro. Check, check, there I am. All right, it was on. How are you guys doing this morning? Woo! I said, how are you doing this morning? Give me a thumbs up if you're doing really good. That's what I'm talking about. That's what I'm talking about. Well, I want to welcome you this morning to New Hope Metro. If it's your very first time, we are so thankful that you're here. We've actually got a table in the back called the Metro Hub. It's just for you. It's a place where you can find out what's going on. You can get connected. Speaking about getting connected, if you've got your bulletin with you, pull out this piece of paper right now. It's called Metro Announcements. Pull it out with me. I just want to highlight just a couple things this morning. But before we get to any of that stuff, if you're in high school, that's grades 9 through 12, high schoolers, grades 9 through 12, and you're in this place, you're in the wrong place. Because New Hope Metro, we've got an exciting new high school ministry, and it's happening right over there in the ministry center. So if you're in a high school, grades 9 through 12, let's give these guys a huge hand as they all get up and head over to the ministry center. All right. They have a ton of fun. It's a lot of fun. What happens over yonder? I'm from Colorado. That's why I said yonder. You know what? We've got a bunch of stuff going on. How many mighty men do I have in this place? Say who? That was pretty good. I think you can do better. How many mighty men of valor do we have in this place? Say who? That's right. We had a great men's ministry meeting yesterday. It was especially awesome for me because my dad was able to come and bring the word. We had a great time. But you know what? We're not forgetting about the ladies. How many Metro ladies do we have in this place? Say hi. That had some good. Here, let's try it again. Say hi. That's what I'm talking about. You know what? We have something coming up for you guys here in just a couple weeks on Saturday, March 23rd at 8:30 a.m. It's here at the Ministry Center. We're going to have childcare. We're going to have all kinds of stuff. So men, please take note of this. Your wives are going, okay? So you got the kids. You got to clean the house, do whatever you got to do. You got to make sure that they get to it because it is going to be a lot of fun. Let's hear our Metro ladies say hi. That's just fun. It's just fun. It's just fun. You know what? Next week, we're going to have a cruise ship here as well. So please make sure that if you want to get here, you want to get here a little bit early because you're going to have to probably park over at Topa Tower. Irwin Park will be open, but because of the cruise ship, the Pier 10 parking is going to be taken. I want to talk about something. How many people here, this is Hawaii, but how many people here love some reggae music? Where are my reggae people at? That's what I'm talking about. Well, I have some exciting news here in just a couple weeks. On March 24th, we're actually going to have Christafari here in this place. I know. Christafari is going to be here. They're going to be doing a concert. It's going to be a blast. So here in just a couple weeks, the week before Easter. So this is a great opportunity to invite your friends, invite your family to not just hear some great music, which we have, but some great reggae music, man. You know what I'm talking about? That's my best. I don't know. So make sure, invite some friends. They're going to be here in just a couple weeks on a Sunday morning. Isn't that exciting? Look at your neighbor and say, that's exciting. You know, the whole reason why we do everything we do here is to take those that are far from God and connect them to life in Jesus. That's really the whole reason why we do. In fact, that's why we're bringing the reggae band in. That's why we sing songs. That's why we do all this stuff is to show God that He is the priority in our lives. And this morning, as we get ready to take up our tithes and our offerings, I want to encourage you. It's not just a money thing. It's not about all the ways that the enemy wants to tell you. It's just about their money. It's just all they care about is your money. You know what? God doesn't care about your money. He doesn't. He cares about your heart. He cares about you making Him priority in your life. And one of the ways we can do that is we can come out and we can come to this place and we can raise our hands and we can lift up to Him our voices and our hearts, but we can also give Him what's important to us, and that's our finances. And so I'm going to pray real quick, and as I pray, I want you to ask God, what do you want me to give this morning? And I want you to listen to His voice. I want you to let Him challenge you as we give this morning, as we worship in that way. God, in this place, we ask that You would speak to us, Lord. We ask, Father, that You would be lifted up in our lives. We worship You in this. In Jesus' name. Ushers, go ahead.
The Lord is my light and sound.
Extend your hands and your heart this morning. God, we thank you for your grace. God, we thank you for your mercy. Lord, we thank you that we can come and that we, Father, we can give of our finances. We can give you our worship, Lord. And God, we pray that you would multiply it. God, you would multiply it. You would bless it, Father, so that we can reach souls for you. God, in this place, we thank you, God. And God, and I pray that you would bless every person this morning that gave, that you would multiply what they have so that we can just worship you and glorify you more. In Jesus' name, and everybody said, amen. Amen. How many people struggled with the races this morning? With the half marathon, you had a hard time parking. You know what? I did as well. And so, normally, I only live a couple blocks here. I live up on a Vineyard Street, and so Sunday mornings, usually what I'll do is I'll jump on my skateboard, and I'll ride down here. And so, this morning, I woke up, and we got to be here at 6 in the morning. So I grabbed my board, and I started going, and it started raining really bad. I'm like, this is not going to work. So I turned around, I went back, and I tried to find an umbrella, and I couldn't find an umbrella. And by that time, it was pouring. So I'm like, all right, I'll just jump in the car. So I got in the car and I started heading down here and I ran into some detours, okay? And so I'm like turning left and now, but I wanna go that way and turning left, but I wanna go that way. And so finally I ended up all the way over by Restaurant Row. That's the closest I could find to park. I'm like, I live closer than this. Oh, what am I gonna do? And we're supposed to be here at 6 and I'm like, so I turned around and I went back home. I'm like, I'm trying to find this umbrella and I looked in the back seat of the car and I find this. It's my daughter's umbrella. I'm like, oh, okay. So I parked the car, I grabbed the umbrella. I'm like, okay, here we go. And it's pouring. And so I'm gonna start walking. And normally when you're walking at 6:30 in the morning, there's not very many around, but turns out there was a half marathon going on this morning. So there was a police officer at every intersection and tons of racers. The worst part was is I couldn't even hide my face. So I'm sitting there, I'm like, this is an epic failure. I got here, we're supposed to be here at 6. I got here at 6:45 this morning with my umbrella. But I made it. And the question today is, how do you deal with failure? I'm going to say that again. How do you deal with failure? I want you to watch this movie clip of a father dealing with failure, providing for his son.
It's not a time machine. Dad, it's not a time machine. Guy said it was a time machine. It's not a time machine. He was wrong.
What guy?
The guy. He was at the park. He said it was a time machine.
Yes, it is.
No, it's not.
It is.
No, it's not.
All we gotta do is push this black button right here. You wanna push it?
Okay.
Come on, man. Right here. Wait a minute. Where you wanna go?
Almost, someplace from before.
You gotta close your eyes.
You close your eyes. I wanna see.
All right, come on, we'll push it together. You gotta close your eyes, close your eyes. It takes a few seconds. Oh my goodness. What? Open, open, open.
What is it?
Dinosaurs.
Where?
You don't see all these dinosaurs? Look around. Look at all these dinosaurs. Wow. You see them?
Yeah.
Hey, come on, come on, come on. Wait, watch out.
What is it?
Don't step in the fire. We're cavemen. But we need this fire because there's no electricity and it's cold out here, okay?
Watch out, watch
Whoa,
out.
Oh my goodness, a T-Rex. That's a T-Rex. Get your stuff. Get your stuff. Get it. We gotta find someplace safe.
Like what?
We need a cave.
A cave?
We gotta find a cave. Come on. Come on, come on. Wait, watch your back. We got, here it is. Here's a cave. Come on. Right here, right here. Go, go, go. Get it, get it. Hurry, hurry.
Like the rising sun, and when that day comes.
see your face, I will shout your endless glorious praise. If I had no voice, if I had no tongue, I would dance for you like the rising sun. When that day comes and I see your face, I will shout your endless glorious praise. You are the song, you are the song I sing. You are the air, you are the air I breathe in.
Turn to your neighbor and say, good morning. Welcome to New Hope Metro. My name is Brandon. I'm the assistant pastor here. I just wanted to thank you for your continued prayers for my father, Elwin Ahu. He's recovering well, but just keep praying for him as he goes through the process of getting stronger. You know, we're in the second week of our series called Fear Factor or Faith Factor, depending on how you look at it. But like we usually do, we try to mix it up a little bit, get you to talk to one another. So here's the question for today. I'm going to give you a question. Talk to the people next to you, in front of you, and in back of you. I believe community is one of the strongest parts of our church. Here's the question. Do you eat raw fish? Yes or no? If no, why not? If yes, where is the best place for it? Go ahead, talk about it. Bring it back. Now, I know that some of you have the spots where to get the best poke on the island. And I know some of you know where the best sashimi is too. So, we'll talk story afterwards, all right? Come see me. I'll write down some notes and everything. Hey, my friends called me up one night when I first came back from college. Said, let's go fishing. And I said, sounds great. I've always wanted to be a fishing kind of guy, but I'm not really, honestly. I'm kind of townie, you know? Some of you townies are fishing guys, but I'm not. And, you know, come take me with you. I'm good company. So anyways, they say, let's go fishing. I said, okay. So they give me a giant pole, and they say, bring a beach chair and a cooler. All right. Pick me up about 9:30 at night, and we drive out to the west side by Yokes out there. Four-wheeling out there, and we're sitting on beach chairs. By this time, it's towards 10:30, 11 o'clock, and I'm trying to tie a hook with this little clear string at night. Really. So I can't see nothing for nothing, so they give me this little headlamp, and I put this headlamp on, and I'm trying to look in this little spotlight, untying this hook, and I'm horrible at this. I'm hooking my finger, and then they give me this stink squid, and I'm like, oh my goodness, what am I doing out here? So finally, we get the lines in the water. We're sitting out there, and it's getting late, but I'm excited because there is the prospect of fish. And at nighttime, in the dead of the night, when everyone's sleeping on their beach chairs, they have these little bells they clip to the fishing pole, right? And I sit there, you're just waiting and waiting and waiting for the ding-ding, 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 It's like you go to Vegas or something, right? And it's like, oh my gosh. So finally they go and they check their poles, and everybody's pole rings but mine. And I'm thinking, what, did I spit on my hands when I tied the hook? Or what's going to do I not smell attractive to a fish? Like, what do I got to do? Make kissy noises through the fishing pole? What the heck? The whole night goes through. Not one ding, 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 ding for me at all. No big winner, big money. Not at all. And people are catching papio and o'io and something, 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 and all this stuff. But I didn't catch nothing. And I thought, what a disappointment. I could have been sleeping in my own bed, not some chunky beach chair, you know? And instead, I thought I was going to make it big, but I made it nothing and small and whatevers. But you know what's funny? Isn't life sometimes like that? We have high aspirations and high expectations, and we think that things are going to go so well. And the day that we stood at the altar, we said, it's going to be the best marriage ever. And the day that kid came into the world, there was joy on our faces. We were so excited. And the first day of school, we sat at our desk and said, this year is going to be different from every other year. And before we asked for their number or whatever it might have been, we said, oh, they're going to say yes. But then life and the reality of life sets in, doesn't it? And the disappointments of people and of situations and the market that fluctuates up and down not only makes us disappointed, but makes us afraid. Because all of us have failed, haven't we? And all of us have failed in different ways, in different places and experiences, in different circumstances. And whether people have failed you or you have failed people, there are issues in our lives. There are chapters on the past of the book of our lives that say, oof, if we could do this chapter over again, if I could take that magic eraser and just go ahead and rub those pages down, I'd type out a different story in my life. In the second week, we're going to address the idea of fear of failure. Because it doesn't matter what you believe about God, whether you're a Christian or not, the fact of the matter is each of us has failed. I don't think any of us is excited to fail again. In fact, fear of failure is probably one of the fears that grips all of us equally, if you will. But at the same time, in a strange paradox, although we all equally experience it, some of us to different degrees, and when it happens to you, it feels like it's the worst thing in the world, doesn't it? You know, when we think about it, watching this clip, which is so powerful from the movie The Pursuit of Happiness, you see Will Smith's character going from job to job, trying to make it. And he's got a young son, obviously, and he wants to provide the best life that he can for his kid. As many parents do, he wants to give him the best opportunities, but he finds himself in a place of failure, spending the night in a restroom at a train station. And you see the tear rolling down his face as he realized, I've failed myself and my child. And I think many of us have been through circumstances where we say, I've not only failed myself, but others in my life. I've not only failed myself and others, but sometimes I even feel like I failed God. But my friends, this morning, my goal is to give us a hope that when we walk out of these doors, we can say, yes, we've been through failure, but my God is greater, and I am not afraid. In fact, as we just sang in that song, The Lord is My Light and Salvation, a song that wasn't invented a couple of years ago, but generations and thousands of years prior, David wrote in Psalms, The Lord is my light and salvation. Whom shall I fear? And when we read things like that and we say, whom shall I fear? There's really, it takes guts, like I was saying earlier. It takes guts to remember that although fear can be deflating and defeating, that we've got to be able to call it for what it is. Fear is a lie. Fear is a lie that will tell you, because of that, you won't do this. Because of that, you'll never amount to this. That because of that, you should be afraid. And fear of failure will leave us stuck, paralyzed, with concrete shoes, not being able to move forward into what God has for you and I. And if you want God's best in your life, say amen. I'm sure you do. What's funny is that people that don't even believe in God will probably say amen to that too. Because the fact of the matter is we serve a loving God that does have a best for us. But like we said last week, fear is going to be the cap. It's going to be the lid. It's going to be the roof to all that God can do in our lives. We must be willing to not only break through fear, but to say, I am not afraid. So, the Lord is my light and salvation. Whom shall I fear? Fear of failure is one of the things that we're going to tackle. How do we do that? Let's start by leveling the playing field. It's hard though sometimes when we compare ourselves to others and we see what they have or what their marriage looks like or what their kids are doing, whatever it is. You know what? Let's level the playing field. We're going to give a couple of pointers. You can write them if you want. You can follow along if you like. It's up to you. But here's the first one. We've all failed. Everyone in this room has failed. We failed in our marriages. We failed in business. We failed as parents. We failed as spouses. We failed in relationships. We failed in tests and classes and had to repeat classes for that matter because we failed. We had to pay tuition again because we had an F in that class. Sometimes we had to pay for the ring again because we failed in that marriage. Sometimes we had to do it over again with the next kid that came along because we feel like we failed the first one. We've all failed. Ecclesiastes 7 says it like this, that when it comes down to it, indeed there is no one on earth who is righteous, not even one who does what is right and never sins. Here's a different translation. There is no one on earth who does what is right all the time and never makes a mistake. Now, I know that you just said, duh, everybody makes mistakes. But let that sit in a little bit. Because I bet you think your stink is more stink than someone else's stink, right? That you look at your junk and say, oh, my junk is more ugly than theirs. But you know what's funny? They're trying to hide their junk too. So you just see the tip of the iceberg. We've all failed. And this church will never be a place where people will be judged and said, ew, you're gross. Because as soon as that's said, it's realized that, ew, I'm gross too. And sometimes we're a big church full of gross people trying to look nice and put on fancy clothes, but hiding the fact that we're gross. That we're all sinners, amen? And yet, at the same time, for those of us that call on Jesus as our Savior, we're all washed clean by the blood of the Lamb. It's this strange two-footed paradox of saying, I stand on the truth of the Word and yet the grace of God. The truth of the Word, knowing that I am sinful and I deserve the wrath of God because of what I've done and said and thought. And yet, the grace of God says that He loves me so much that He calls me a son, that He calls you a daughter, and says, walk with me in your brokenness. We're all broken. And as you might have heard in other churches, it's going to be true here too. This church is going to be a hospital for the sick, not a beauty pageant for the holy. So come, come bus up on Sunday morning and be loved. Because we all wrestle with a fear of failure. And if we recognize that we all are on the same playing field, it makes the proud a lot more humble. And it makes the downtrodden a lot more up, knowing that God has called us all the same. Amen? So if that's the fact of the matter, that we're all failures in some way, I love the idea that the Bible shows us the same thing. That from cover to cover, it's filled with people that tried to live for God and failed in different ways. That even if you start from the beginning, Adam and Eve failed. That's why we're in this position, right? Moses failed. David failed. Solomon failed. 1,000-time concubine failed, right, Russell? Failed. You see, everyone in the Bible has failed in different ways. The only person that didn't was Jesus, but his followers failed. Guys that spent 3 years with a living, breathing, talking Son of God. Don't you think that if God actually showed up, that your life would be so much different? Right? That all of a sudden I'd get over these temptations and I wouldn't be such a doofus and I'd walk in faith. These guys are with Jesus. They still bit it. They still face planted and they're probably on fail blog all the time back in their day. Fail scroll, whatever. You see, the disciples followed Jesus, but they still failed. And as we talked about about 2 months ago, we looked at the story of Peter, how he denied Jesus Christ. We're going to take a look at that one more time from a different angle, but then we're going to break off into a different part of it. If you're new to church, Peter was pretty much Jesus' right-hand man for the most part. He was brash, he was arrogant, he spoke first, thought second, kind of like some of us do, or maybe your relatives, I don't know. And Peter said things to Jesus in front of people just out of great bravado. Jesus, even if all others fall away from you, I never will. I'll go with you to the grave. And when he was called out on that, when someone said, I'm all in, show me your hand, Peter ran like a little girl. You know, we see it in Luke chapter 22 that Peter gets convicted because even though he said he would never run from Christ, he does. Jesus is arrested, as the story goes, and many of you know, and put on trial in front of everyone. And when Peter goes to look and watch to see what's happening, he's interrogated by followers of the trial. And as the crowd around him gathers in and says, hey, you were with Jesus, knowing that if he admitted it, he could be on trial for his life as well, Peter tucked his tail between his legs and ran. We're going to throw the scripture on the wall so you see the context in which Peter's cowardice shows itself. Luke 22:61. After he said that, he said, "I don't know Jesus." And the Lord turned and looked at Peter, and Peter remembered the word of the Lord, how he had told him, "Before the cock crows today, you will deny me three times." And Peter went out and wept bitterly. He wept because he remembered the things that he had said, and he was frustrated, full of despair and hopelessness. Aren't those the things that happen to us in the midst of our failure? That when we fail, when we recognize, oh, that's where I should have been, and this is where I am. Oh. You know what's funny? Failure comes in two different categories, generally speaking. Sometimes it's specific instances of failure, when you lose the account, when you're called onto something and you say, "I don't know." When you get the F, when you're embarrassed in front of everybody, sometimes failure is specific to an instance. Other times, failure is the culmination of a life lived where we say, "How did I get here?" When we look at that video and we see him sleeping in the restroom saying, "How did I get here? What has my life amounted to? Is this really it? How did I get into this predicament? I never thought that I'd be 32 as a divorcee. In my wildest imagination, I never thought I'd be a single parent. Never did I ever think that my business would fail to this magnitude. My family was not supposed to be like this." Failure can be an instance or the culmination of a long string of events. Or for some of us, failure could be the idea of saying, "I know what I should have done, and I didn't. My life hasn't amounted to anything." And while there aren't specific mountain peaks or actually valleys of failure that I can point out and say that's one thing, really it's a culmination of indifference. I feel like a failure. Failure hits us all in different ways. When we look at the example of Peter, we recognize that something happened, right? That something happened. That when he went from coward to hero, something happened. It's kind of like, you know when you see a real scrawny guy, you know, like me, right? You see a real scrawny guy, and a couple months later, he's like, "Something happened to you. What have you been eating? Steak 24/7, you know, something like that. Something happened. With Peter, something happened. He went from guy that ran to guy that preached, and people came to Christ. And we're going to look at Peter's response to his failure, and how do we respond in the midst of ours. Here's a couple of things we're going to write down real quick, kind of lightning round issue right here real quick. First of all, recognize failure is inevitable. You will fail. And it doesn't feel good to hear it, but it's true, so let's eat it. We will fail. And if we're afraid to do it, we'll never get over it. But here's the thing. What's going to distinguish us from the world is not a life free from failure, but how you respond to it. How you respond when you endure failure. How you respond to trial. Whether you shirk in fear from it again, or whether you step up and say, "Who shall I fear? I will not be afraid." You know, when I first met my wife, we weren't even dating yet, we were friends, and I was kind of seeing, like, you know, what her life was like and everything, and Jamie's family are athletes, and her brother is about maybe 6'2", 6'3", played linebacker in high school and college, so you can imagine, we stack up and match up pretty well, right? Nope. So I go up to her house one day to pick her up, we're going to go hang out as friends. I drive to the house, and I go up to the door, and I knock on the door, and this giant Japanese guy answers the door. "What?" "Hey, is Jamie home?" "Why, who are you?" "Her friend." So Jamie comes out, she goes, never mind. So she comes out with me, "Sorry." So we're driving down. I go, "Hey, what's with your brother?" She goes, "Oh, he's just really protective. It's been the two of us for most of our life. And I have half siblings, but he's my full brother and just really protective of me." No joke. The next time I went over, he answers the door with a big kitchen knife. And it's almost like I instantly dorked out, you know, because I got, like, intimidated. Like, "Pardon me. Pardon me, sir." You know, and then I read David's psalm. "The Lord is my light and salvation. Whom shall I fear? Who shall I be afraid? Why should I be afraid? The Lord is my light and salvation." And all of a sudden, guts started to grow in me. And I said, "I'm not going to be afraid." So I call her phone, and like good siblings do, he picks up her phone for her, right? "Who this?" This is Brandon. Kind of funny how you get guts when you're not face to face, yeah? When you're online, you get choked guts. Oh, you know what she did, right? But face to face, you never do that. This is Brandon. Can I talk to Jamie? She says, give me a hard time, right? So, the Lord is my light and salvation, right? Who shall I fear, right? So, I take a deep breath and I puff up my chest on the phone. And I go, hey man, look, I'm not afraid of you, all right? Is Jamie there? Our relationship is great, my brother-in-law, but you know, it's funny because it made me realize there's so many things that can make us afraid, yeah? There's so many situations that can intimidate us. There's so many things and people and situations and failures that can almost feel like they intimidate us. But failure is inevitable, but it's not if you fail. And because of that, let's not be afraid of it. Let's accept the fact that it's gonna happen. Parents, you know this. When your kids are young, they're so cute, right? You love them, you hug them, they love you, they hug you. And then something happens, and they start growing hair in funny places and thinking about the opposite sex, and they don't want to hug you anymore, right? It's inevitable. It's going to happen. So let's get ready for it. In the same way, let's get ready for it now. You will fail. It's how you respond that makes the world of the difference, not running in fear from it. The Lord is my light and salvation. Whom shall I fear? I am not afraid. In fact, say that with me with confidence. I am not afraid. And if we can live, I am not afraid. If we can live, I am not afraid, then we're going to see a difference in the way that we live and how the world interprets the God that we serve. There's a difference. That failure is inevitable, but also failure is temporary. That while it's inevitable, it's also temporary. Failure is not going to last forever. And sometimes it feels like it's going to last forever. That sometimes the mortification and embarrassment of when your mom says, hi, sweetie, it's going to last forever. Sometimes, parents, you do that on purpose, don't you? But it's temporary. No matter how long it might be, it's a temporary issue. In fact, Peter, the one that was the disciple that ran, actually wrote a book in the Bible called 1 Peter. In fact, he wrote two. He called it 2 Peter. How original. And in 1 Peter, he actually says something about the temporal, how it's not going to last forever, okay? Turn with me in your Bibles to 1 Peter chapter 5. Take your time getting there. It's way in the back. If you hit Revelation, you went too far. So it's before Revelation, right before there. In fact, keep bringing your Bibles. We're going to get into them together. In 1 Peter 5, Peter is addressing the believers. These are followers of Christ in a hostile society where if you believed in Christ, you're not only ridiculed and mocked. Does that sound like any of your workplaces or families? You're not only ridiculed or mocked, but contrary to our society back then, you could be put in jail and have all your possessions taken away from you because of what you believed. Religious freedom was not even an idea then. And in fact, it escalated so strongly in the Roman Empire that finally people were killed for their faith. They were martyred. Nowadays, we can't really imagine or fathom that. Now, maybe in countries like China, maybe, but nowadays in America, heck no. So taking a book like 1 Peter, in chapter 5, we see Peter telling them, these afflictions, these sufferings you're facing, they're temporary, but not forever. Let's take a look at what he says. 1 Peter 5, and we're in verse 10. He says, after you have suffered for a little while, the God of all grace, who called you to his eternal glory in Christ, will himself perfect, confirm, strengthen, and establish you. That after you've suffered for a little while, that the God of grace will do these things in your life. That after you've suffered for a little while, after you suffered for how long? For a little while. That the God of grace will come in and perfect and confirm that he was with you the whole time anyway. And what's funny is a little while, doesn't that seem so arbitrary? Let me be honest, it is. It's not after you suffer for 2 weeks or 2 months or even if you put an end goal of 2 years. It's the arbitrary, unsettled feeling of a season. That after you've suffered for a little while, Peter tells believers, the God of grace says he's going to be with you because he always has been. And then he's going to show you, man, I was with you the whole time you went through it. But you know what's funny? It's just like how children can't understand our concept of time. That when you tell a kid, oh, we're going to go vacation to so-and-so's house next year. They don't really understand that, maybe. Or maybe if you put them in timeout or you keep them silenced for like 10 minutes. Were you a kid and your parents made you be quiet for 10 minutes? I was a fidgety kid. And my grandmother said, I will give you $5 if you sit still for 5 minutes. Didn't happen. Obviously, I haven't changed, but back then, it felt like eternity, but it was a little while, wasn't it? In the same way, in the midst of our failures, it feels like our sufferings are a long time. It feels like it's forever, but the Bible tells us you're suffering for a little while, admittedly. It's true, but God is with you, and He hasn't forgotten about you. So don't let your failure define you, because God is still with you. Don't let it be your cap. He's still with you. So failure is inevitable. It's temporary. So what do we do in the midst of it? Here's what we do. Focus on the big picture. You can write that in. Focus on the big picture. The minutia of failure makes us feel like it's so small, but we have to remember that in the midst of everything, God has the big picture already written. He is the author and perfecter of our faith. That He has written the beginning and the end. He not only has written the beginning and the end as an author, but also at the same time, He even says, I am the beginning and the end. You think He's owning that one? Heck yeah, He is. He's telling us, I got you. That in Hebrews, when He says He's the same yesterday, today, and forever, it's not only His timelessness, it's His control over eternity and even your life. In fact, take a look at Luke 22. We're going to throw it on the wall. You don't have to turn there. Keep your finger in 1 Peter. We're going to go back there. Luke 22. Jesus says to Peter that Satan has demanded to sift you like wheat. Quick side note, I thought this was really fun, I'd like to share with you. Peter had two names, kind of like how you have two names. Maybe your mom calls you one name, and then when she's mad at you, she calls you your whole name. Or maybe if you're Hawaiian, you got a Hawaiian name, you go by two names. Same thing with Peter. He was known by Simon. Okay. I think Peter was really Chinese because his name was Simon, yeah? But then I bet he had a Japanese cousin named Ramen. Never mind his Filipino neighbor, Pansit, right? So anyways, Simon, he was renamed Peter because Peter was Greek for rock. And Jesus said, on this rock I will build my church. But here, Peter's going to be tested, and Jesus calls it. Jesus says, you know what, dude, you don't see it. I'm the Son of God. I see what's going to happen. And Simon, Satan has asked to sift you like wheat, meaning he wants a piece of you. Satan has asked. Who did Satan ask? Himself? Nope. He asked God. Satan had to go through God to put Peter through that trial. The whole denying Christ thing, God actually allowed that to happen. And at the end of the failure, Jesus tells Simon Peter, but when you have returned and you've strengthened yourself, strengthen your brothers, because you're going to return. Do you see the control that Jesus has, the big picture view? That Jesus is saying, I got the big picture. So when you fail, don't freak out, because I got you. When you fail, come back to me. I got you. Don't lose sight of the big picture. I'm still in control. And you know what? Notice how much confidence God has, even in the midst of the failures. And if God has this kind of confidence, why shouldn't we? That He's with us and He's going to help us to get through our failures, so let's not be afraid of them when they happen. Let's disempower the failures that have held their grip on us for so long. You know, we don't see the big picture, though, do we? In our failures, we just see the isolated incident. I blew it. I did it again. I said I'd never go there. I said I'd never be with her again. I did it again. We just see the failure. We don't see the big picture. It's almost like in baseball. All you see is the strikeout. And when you strike out, you feel like a failure. You don't see you're in the midst of a bigger game than that. The game's not over, sweetie. The game's not over. You know, I played baseball for a couple years in my life. Many of you know this, and I own this because this is my life. My dad was really athletic. He won national championships in volleyball in college. I am totally unathletic. I won national championships in Super Mario Brothers by myself. So I played soccer for a bunch of years, and I was horrible. I played for like 5 or 6 years, never scored one goal. You know what my motivating factor for scoring a goal was? My dad said, if you score a goal, I'll buy you a Happy Meal. I should score a goal. I never did. Always playing with the cockroaches, ball going right by. See you later, ball. I got this guy. I'll name you Reggie. You know, something like that. But I did play baseball after that. Soccer's no good. Why don't you try baseball? Okay. I remember three things from baseball. They're not good things. I remember that on picture day, everybody had the blue hat with the L on it for Lanakila. I played for Lanakila. But it was kind of funny, is you have an L on your hat, you look like a loser, right? So I lost my hat. So I show up and they give me a dark blue generic hat. And out of all the kids in the picture, only one doesn't have the L. One of these things is not like the other. And I'm like, who looks like the loser now? The second thing I remember is they taught us how to field grounders. When you hit the ball rolls on the ground, not in the air. And on the ground, you gotta, and then pick it up and cover the thing so it doesn't roll up into your face, right? So you cover the glove, get the grounder, and then whoosh, whoosh, kind of thing. So one day in the game, I'm in the outfield, because that's where you put the challenged kids. And I'm in the back, and the ball rolls out to me. Oh, it's you. Sorry, Reggie, hold on. And I bend over for the grounder, okay? And I go down, and I feel... Oh, I wore bibbidis today. Okay, good. The last thing I remember is every time I was at bat, every time I was at bat, I either walked or struck out. Every time. I'd be up there and, oh, I hated it. Hey, batter, leave me alone. Stop talking to me. Every time. And every time I walked, I'm like, oh, thank you. But every time I struck out, I cried. Oh, I would cry. Why would you hate this game? And I remember when all of this was happening, I'd walk into the dugout, and the coach would tell me, consoling me like coaches do, it's okay, Ahu. Even Jose Canseco strikes out. It's okay. Thanks, coach. In the midst of failure, all we see is the strikeout, don't we? That's all we see. We don't see that the game's still going on. We don't see that it's not over yet. Because none of us are really in the ninth inning of our lives necessarily. Whether you're young or old, it doesn't mean the game's over, because even after death, the game's not over. There's an eternity for those who believe. And that's the beauty of it. The beauty of it is that because of Jesus, there is an eternity for you and I. So whatever happens here, let's do the best that we can to follow Him, but let's not let fear inhibit us. It's temporary. It's not over. Let's keep the big picture in mind. It reminds me of this story of a farmer who owned a donkey that fell down a well. Farmer looks down, donkey ain't getting out of the well. It's too expensive to get a big crane and take the donkey out. And the farmer thinks, I can't let the animal starve to death. He says, I'm just going to put it out of its misery. So he gets, not a gun, that's not very cool, not in the story, and he gets dirt. He starts to shovel it into the hole, thinking, I'll just bury the donkey. But donkey, smart guy. He looks around and he goes, I'm in a hole. Can't get out there. And he feels this dirt in his head. Psh, what the heck? Dirt falling more on him, falls on his shoulder, and he goes, ooh. Dirt falls down another shoulder. Ooh. Hey, step up on the dirt. This farmer's shoveling more dirt, and it keeps falling on donkey, and he shakes it off, and he steps up. And he shakes it off, and he steps up. And little by little, the donkey is rising with the dirt coming up until the donkey comes up through the well and says, you are gonna bury me. That was from the movie Shrek. No, I'm just kidding. See, that's what we gotta do. When dirt falls on us, when we fall into a pit and everybody starts dumping on us, you gotta shake it off and step up. You gotta shake it off and step up. Wouldn't it be fun if we all stood up and started going? We're not gonna do that, all right? Someone breaking a hip or something, you know? But I want you to remember it. I want you to remember that when you fail, you choose to either go, oh, life's dumping on me again. Same old, stuck in a hole with nowhere to go, can't get up, just gonna let it pile up on me. Or you can choose to shake it off, step up. The wonder of it is that you choose, that no one chooses for you, do they? Is that you and I need to be people that choose whether we move past failure or we stay on it. When it comes down to it, God has a bigger plan. And sometimes, this is, hear me clearly on this one. Sometimes God allows us to fail. Sometimes he allows us to go through different parts of life where we fail blatantly and horribly. Sometimes he allows us to fail because it's a part of the bigger plan. Sometimes you do a sacrifice fly because it's a part of the bigger plan. I'm not saying he's sacrificing you, hear me clearly. He allows us to fail because it's a part of his plan that you might grow, that Christ might be formed in you. You know, when I first came back from college, my first year, I did really well at USC my first year there, and I thought I was the man. Some people have testimonies like drugs and alcohol. Christ saved me from that. Those are amazing testimonies. My story is not like that. And for years, I kind of degraded myself because I said, I wish I had a drug, sex, and rock and roll prison kind of testimony because I could stand on stage and everybody would clap for me. I'm just a church kid. Oh, shucks, you know? But I came to realize that my testimony is as powerful as anybody's because it's not me. It's the power of God. And it's not people that have been through drugs. It's the power of God. It's not people that have been through divorces or pornography addictions or through prison or through anything. It's the power of God, and that's what matters. My testimony is when God freed me from arrogance and self-centeredness. I graduated from, from high school, yeah, and then went to college, finished my first year, had really good grades. I thought I was the man. And I came back as an arrogant 18-year-old thinking I could get any job I wanted. And this, just don't mock me too much on this one, okay? But my aspirations as an 18-year-old, my career goals were to work at a surf shop for the summer. Because surf shops is where you make the money and you get the discount on the nice clothes and you get all the girls, you know what I'm saying? Girls love surf shop guys. So I walk into this place, 18-year-old, right? And I walk in with my resume and cover letter and I say, I'd like to apply for a job. And then I slowly scanned throughout the surf shop and I saw all the girls whose numbers I'd get and I saw all the guys who worked there that I said, if this loser can work here, I could be the manager. And I walked out of the shop thinking that job was mine. I didn't get hired by any shop at all. I felt like an idiot. Giant poser failure. Meanwhile, my dad just started over at New Hope Staten Island, and he goes, hey, you want to work at the church? And I said, Dad, you don't understand. I'm going to work at a surf shop. Girls, clothes, you know, that kind of thing. So when that didn't happen, as a failure, I walked back to Dad and said, hey, you still got a job? That summer, I didn't work a glorious, glamorous job. In fact, I worked a horrible job. Instead of waiting the counter and helping girls to pick out bikinis and being in the fast life there, I worked at a church where I scrubbed toilets and I hung out with urinals as I wiped them down to close the ministry center, and I hated every minute of it. And I stacked chairs and I vacuumed the lead center, and I was like, what am I doing? I feel like a loser. But through that summer, God had a bigger plan as a part of my life. Some of you guys know Pastor Dominic Kaihui, kind of guy. He was my boss. Oh, I got humble real quick. Big, strong Hawaiian guy. And as I was scrubbing toilets, God started to change my heart. I remember one night in particular, as I was serving and I was doing this whole bathroom deal, it was about 9:30, 10 o'clock on a Friday or Saturday night. And all my friends were calling me up on my flip phone going, hey, we're going to go clubbing. We're going to go to World Cafe. Let's go. Oh, yeah, World Cafe. Yeah. So I'm trying to finish this up so I can get out of here. I'm trying to finish working at church so I can go to the nightclub. So I'm finishing up and I'm kind of bitter and it's taking longer than I thought. Like, I got to do all this. I hate this job. It's just the worst. So I'm in the bathroom by myself, just angry and fuming. And one of the uncles who was volunteering in the tape ministry, walks into the bathroom. He looks at me, he can see something's wrong, he goes, hey, you all right? Yeah, I'm all right. But he presses, you all right? And I figure, no better time than now. I just dump it all on him, right? I'm awesome, surf shop, I'm doing this, I'm a loser, no girls, World Cafe, I wanna get out of here, I hate this thing, urinals, no! I'm just angry. He listens. He goes, that's pretty horrible, man. And then so gently, he starts telling me about his life before he met Christ. Not in a preachy way, but just in a, I understand. And he goes, hey, B, you know why I'm here on Friday night doing tape ministry? You know why I'm copying cassette tapes? Because this is what my life was like before Jesus. I was doing this, and our marriage was like this. And then Jesus came into our lives and it changed. It changed this and it changed this. And he goes, and then I realized if Jesus could die for me and pay for my sin, if Jesus could give me new life, how could I not serve him with even a part of mine, even when he's asked for all of it? I said, oh. And I got so convicted, I started to cry. And I realized that I was so self-centered and arrogant and disregarding Jesus. I wanted what I wanted. And on a Friday or Saturday night at about 10:30 by this point, I'm crying in the bathroom with a toilet brush holder, scrubber in one hand, a spray bottle in the other, and I'm hugging another guy in the bathroom. Thank you so much. God totally changed my heart that summer. I started reading the Bible. It's so much better when you read it with friends. I tried reading alone, but meeting with friends and doing devotions together, started journaling together, talking about what God was doing in our lives, it changed everything. And slowly but surely, my heart started to be more inclined to God. I count that as being one of the most foundational summers of my life, but you know how it started? As a failure, as a loser, as an arrogant kid that thought he knew everything about the world, but realized at the end he didn't know nothing about nothing. Sometimes God will allow you to fail because he wants to teach you something in there. Not as a harsh person, but as a kind, gentle father saying, I've got more for you. I'm going to allow you to fail because I've got more for you in this future that I have, the plans that I have versus the plans that you had. And I'm actually saving you from the heartache and the heartbreak and the hardship that you'll face if you walked alone. Oh, in the moment, I don't see that. I just see the strikeout. But as we see the big picture, we realize, God, you've always been in control. So I'm going to trust you. I want to close with this. That when we are hit with failure, we must choose to be faithful and focused to God's bigger picture. Let us remain faithful and focused to the one that says he's always held us. You know, if you've been around church long enough, you know the story of the prodigal son. It's in Luke 15. But I heard it this weekend at the hymn conference in a way that just brought life to me. And I thought it applied so well to this sermon. So as we close, before we pray, let's put it back into our context. You remember the father that was rich and the son that was arrogant went to his father and said, hey, give me my inheritance. And when you say that to a living person, hey, give me what I'd get when you die now, even if you're alive, is basically tell him, go die so I can have your money. And the father, for some reason, gives the son a wealth of inheritance. And if we modernize it today, he took all that money and he flew to Vegas and he partied. Oh, and he raged and he clubbed every night. He had girls everywhere and you should see the friends. Oh, and staying up till 4 a.m. and waking up past 2 p.m. Oh, this guy lived it up. When the debit card ran dry and when Visa declined everything else, when all the bills came back and said insufficient funds, he said, I can't go home. I'm just going to make it on the street. So he hustled and he did what he needed to do. At the end of his rope, he realized, I can't make it out here. I've smoked too many cigarettes with just the last piece of the butt because someone threw it down to realize I can't make it out here. I've dug through too many trash cans to find food because I'm so hungry and all my friends have left me once the money was gone. I can't make it out here. I've collected too many bottles and cans trying to drink something from it to realize I can't make it out here anymore. That I've walked so far, that I've failed so hard, I could never go home. But after sleeping with the pigs and living with the people in life that we would never want to be around, that after running drugs and being with people in circles that he never said he would be a part of, but now he found himself with, he came to his senses and said, I got to get home. So hitching rides down the freeway, he finally made his way back to a place where it was close enough to be home. He came up with an idea. He said, I don't deserve to go home. I mean, I basically told my dad to go die, so I'm expecting to be dead to him. But maybe he's hiring. Maybe he needs a stock boy or a janitor. Maybe he needs someone in the house to vacuum or to scrub urinals or something. Maybe he needs someone like that. So he practices a speech and he rehearses that as he walks home and he says, God, help me to say this to my dad. Father, I've sinned against you and against God. Would you allow me to be a slave, a servant, a janitor, a something? Would you allow me to be at the bottom of the totem pole so maybe, just maybe, I could earn my way back up into your favor, just at least a portion of your favor? As it said, he's walking and the father sees him from a distance. And I imagine a distance is a distance. And the father sees the silhouette and he says, that's my son. And he runs out. Before the boy can even do the speech he'd rehearsed for years, Father, I've sinned against God. And again, the father grabs him, shut up. You're home. Come here. Don't ever think your failure could push you far enough from my grace. We live in a performance-driven society, don't we? The ones that are great get all the applause. And the ones that fail get all the negative looks, all the bad raps. It doesn't matter whether you're on one side or the other. The fact of the matter is God sees us the same. And let's never let our performance, and especially our lack thereof, get in the way of God's love for you. This morning, as we finish up on just a fear of failure, I am not afraid. Because when I fail, I know that God's in control. So whom shall I fear? And in light of and in spite of my past failures, God still sees me as a son. He sees you as a daughter. So why should we be afraid? Fear of failure will be like cement shoes. It'll be like a lid. Only you take the lid off. Only you shake off the shoes and allow yourself to be loved by a father that sees you the way that you really are. As we close in prayer, I'm going to ask you to do two things. The first thing is to bring your failures of the past to the cross. That in your heart and mind, bring those to the Lord and say, Jesus, I don't want to be afraid anymore. I don't want to let these failures loom over me. I don't want these labels to be stuck on me. I don't want the labels that people have placed on me, that loved ones have stamped on me. Would you wash me clean? Second thing I'm going to ask you to do is allow God to give you the hope of the big picture, that He is in control. Always has, always will be. Would you pray with me? Let's pray. Jesus, I thank you that you are the everlasting God, which gives us hope, that you are time-tested, that generations before us and generations after us will follow you and see your promises come true. May we stand in the middle of the two and hold on to the hope that we have. That in spite of our failures, Lord, you are with us and you are for us. That you want our best. So therefore, Lord, let us not be afraid to fail. May the labels fall off. May our hearts and identities be brand new under the blood of Jesus Christ. Lord, I pray for those of us that have been just shackled and paralyzed by fear. Thank you that you hold the key, that there is freedom with your Spirit. So Spirit of God, breathe freedom into our lives that we might follow you stronger now more than ever. And Lord, I know that 30 minutes on a Sunday morning ain't gonna do this. So through our week, would we press into you? Would we press into you to hear your word and your comfort for us? Thank you, Lord, that like the father in the prodigal son story, you love us and you receive us. And when we expected judgment and condemnation, we only found grace. Thank you. We love you because you first loved us. We pray this in Jesus' name, knowing that we are not afraid. And we say together, amen. Let's thank him who is faithful. Church, would you stand with me as we finish in one last song? God bless you. Have a wonderful week.